Hi guys, this is Jason here from Nathaniel. In this lesson, I'm going to introduce you to how I go about my business when I'm having to deal with the topic of fillers, right? Fillers are those arpeggiated runs which you hear very often, you know. Sometimes it comes in very quickly. The whole idea is to create some flair or in plain and simple just to show off. Or sometimes if you're accompanying a band, you'll have an occasion where maybe the singers finish the sentence, finish a phrase of singing, and then in the gap, you could kind of lead into the next thing. So it could be musical, it could be something the song needs, or it could be something you just add as flavor to the song whenever possible or whenever you get the chance. Or if it's an instrumental song, I guess you can do it pretty much all the time, right? So traditionally, the way you play runs or fillers, at least a lot of the videos I've seen on the internet, revolve around things like taking a triad and playing that with inversions. And you kind of arpeggiate that and keep climbing. For example, that's your inversions of G minor, which I'm taking for the lesson. Or you could do it in fours, which is a little uncommon because it's a bit trickier to play on the fingers. So that is one way you have your runs or fillers described. The other way is you could take groupings of notes of a scale. Like for example, G minor scale. And now you do your runs as, again, runs of three. That's another common way to do a run. So I've talked about inversions. Then the groups, let's say a trio of notes. Or you can do four notes. Another scale you could consider for your runs would be the pentatonic scale, which is a five-note scale. So you could develop runs on that scale. Yeah, so you can even do major pentatonic. Also nice warm-ups, right? So the runs I'm going to try and describe for you today are going to be things which I do a lot in my music, which I think are quite unique, which you may not find going around on the usual, you know, how to play a piano run lessons. So let's get cracking. Don't forget to watch the lesson till the end. There are quite a few concepts regarding the runs, quite a few theoretical concepts which you could even use in a non piano run show off kind of way. But in the lesson, it's primarily two octaves to just run up and down whenever you need to. So someone will play a chord and you are there and you're expected to play a run, or you want to play a run. This lesson is basically to show you how to play that, or at least how I approach some of my runs, right? Before we get started, it'll be great if you can hit that subscribe button, hit the bell icon for regular notifications, and do consider following us on Patreon, where you're going to get all the notation for these lessons. You have the option of doing a 1 month subscription or a 1 year subscription. Both of these options exist. You'll get a discount, of course, if you do the 1 year. So do consider Patreon for all my handwritten notes, notation wherever applicable, and let's get cracking. So I'm going to start with a major chord as the bass. So that's your G major, which will be GBD. And we'll take one more chord for our exercise. We'll try and do the run on a major chord as well as a minor chord. So if you take a minor chord, it will be GB flat D, doo-doo-doo. Right? It'll be your G major, G minor. So pretty much all the music we develop in this lesson will be around this. So the first kind of run, or almost all the kinds of runs which I will be demonstrating, will revolve around an additional note to the existing triad. The additional notes would be an add to, A being the added to because it's a middle, or again A being the add to because again it's in the middle of the root and the third. You could also call it an add 9 in the case of a minor chord from theoretical objectives. So that's your add 2 or add 9. You can do it with both the major and the minor chord. We don't call this a sus 2. We say add 2 because the 3 is not going anywhere. The 3 will also be there. Then we have the add 4 where you do G major. Okay. You're adding that 4, perfect 4th or sus 4. So add 4. There we go. It goes with both the major and the minor. Then we have the sharp 5 or the flat 6. Or we call it the minor 6th or the augmented 5th. So with a major chord, it works more like an augmented. So we add that embellishment. Okay. You could also do it over a minor chord. Right, very X-Files if you ask me. Right, then you do get it a bit more majestic with the major chord with the major 6th. Right, you get those sort of runs. Then you do a major chord with that augmented 5th squeeze. Everything has its vibe, and the reason why I choose these, so what have we chosen so far? We've chosen the add 2, we've chosen the add 4, and we've chosen the add sharp 5 or flat 6, or we've chosen the add 6. So add 6 could be add 6, it could be add flat 6. Or if you want to call that flat 6 sharp 5, feel free to do so. Okay, so these are the added notes. Now, we could also add a 7 or a 7 flat, but I think then this lesson will get very long. So let's just stick with what we have. And the run or the strategy for developing the run or the piano arpeggio movement would be to keep a few things in mind. One is we want to play over a minimum of 2 octaves so that it sounds and feels a bit fancy. The other thing we want to do is decide before we play the run, do we want to do a triplet run or do we want to do a semi-quaver run? Semi-quaver run or a 30-second note run will be groupings of 4. Dabba 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 dabba. But groupings of 3 would be dabba 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 dabba. Or 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? You have to prepare yourself for a 2-octave strategy. You have to prepare yourself for whether you're going to do triplet runs or whether you're going to do groupings of 4 or semi-quaver runs. And last but not least, you have to figure out, at least with my analogy of describing the runs I do, which is your added note. Are you adding the 2? Are you adding the 4? Are you adding the sharp 4 in some cases? Are you adding the 6 or are you adding the flat 6, also known as augmented 5? And the base, the home base, which you start off with before you cook everything around that, will be the major or the minor chord. For this lesson, we are going to take G major or G minor. Okay, right. So let's get started with the first one, which is add 2. So you take the G major chord, add the 2. So what is the 2 of the G scale? Whether it's G major or G minor, the second note is A, isn't it? On its own, it just sounds quite nice. But with the run, let's try and develop a run. That's your run there, okay? And I'm doing it with triplets. 1 and 2 and 3. You could count it as 3s. Speed it up. I'm just slowing it down so you can see where I'm crossing. Play 3. Then your thumb. Three. You could also go drift your bass to maybe a C, and then the overall vibe becomes like a C major 7th sound. Maybe go to E, giving like a E minor 7th vibe. D sus 4 with a D bass, so G. E minor, same run, C, D sus, right? Of course, you're not going to want to do it for the whole song. You want to do it wherever you get the chance to sneak it in, right? Now, with all these runs, you can start from the bottom or you can start from the top. Both have their own flavor and both are logically possible as well, right? Now, we are doing this run in groups of six. Now, you could also take the same music but accent it in a different way. For example, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, right? You can do it 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a 1E. Right? It sounds a bit weird to count it, but if you think, okay, triplets, you go 1 and a 2 and a 3 and a 4 and a 1 and a 2, right? But if you think groupings of 4 or semi-quavers, you go 1 and a 2 and a 3 and a 4 and a 1. And it doesn't have to necessarily resolve, you know. One E and a 2 E and a 3 E and back to the world of threes. One E and a 2. World of semi-quavers or 16s. Triplets. It's just the feel, or it depends on how your left hand and the right hand are integrating or working together, right? So remember, runs, fillers, I've said this before, think of groupings of 3 or 6, da 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 da, or groupings of 4, da ba da ba da ba da ba da ba da ba da ba, right? So we've done an add 2, and we can do it from the bottom, we can do it from the top. What else shall we do? Well, first of all, you could consider doing the add 2 with a minor chord. Why not? You can even this is the normal one, but if you'd like your pinky fingers available, so you can sneak in the high D as well, right? You can add that, or you can even add like a lower D, or think in terms of four groupings, four note groupings. One and one E and a 2E and a 1E and a 2E and a. That's a bar of 4 or a bar of 2. 1E and a 2E and a takadin a takadino. Tumpatinano re di 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 do. Your run's also getting a lot bigger now, right? Major, minor. So the mechanics kind of remains the same, right? Whether you do it over a major or a minor. Right, guys? So that was the add 2. Let's now move on to the next add thing. Okay? Same G major chord, but now let's consider adding the flat 6 to the chord, which is one of my personal favorites. So you take a G major. So flat 6 will be the E, and then you bring that down by a step, or you consider the flat 6 as an augmented 5, which is the 5 going up. You get that sound? So That's the vibe. Need your ring finger for this one to cross, so it'll be slightly tricky for G. That's your sound there. Right, you could just even play around with those four notes, you know. Do it in a sparse way. Bring in the minor. So if you bring in the minor chord with a flat 6, again, very interesting. Right, you hear this a lot in movies and all these sci-fi kind of programs, right? So I'm doing it in groupings of 4 now. 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and... And there's one little secret which some of us teachers don't tell you. I mean, you might even want to call it a little bit of cheating, but the pedal, the sustain pedal, which we don't talk enough of, is generally pressed during these runs. So that is what really gives you that flow between the notes. But of however, to control the pedal needs a little bit of experience. So some keyboard players, I find with some pianos or some digital keyboards, you have a button which goes like in auto sustain mode. The problem with a button is it has no intelligence. So it's either going to sustain it on fully or you leave it off, right? So I would highly encourage, don't use the button sustain ever, right? Either don't use sustain at all or use an actual sustain pedal. So I'm using a pedal in this particular lesson. So you go, what happens is if you go higher, you can do things like that. And if you spend some time listening to that, you actually hear the harmonics of the sound. Hope you could hear that, right? So the sustain pedal is not just there to sustain. It's there to cling on to the harmonics or enhance the harmonic resonance, which is also there. Remember, every note has a lot of harmonics on any musical instrument. A piano is no different. It has a lot of harmonics or overtones, as we call it. Anyway, coming back. So just remember, I use the pedal while playing, and I guess so should you. But as a kid growing up, our piano at home did not have a pedal. So I used to actually practice this without a pedal, you know. So try to make it sound decent enough or musical enough without the pedal, and then bring in the pedal, which was my sort of old school strategy. So without the pedal, I'm still getting the legato, right? Right? So then you let the pedal enhance your performance. Also give you a little bit of leeway here and there while crossing. So I think we are completely fine with that. So we've done a major and minor chord with an added flat 6 or an augmented 5 or that one, right? And do it, you don't have to do it in this stringent run-like way. You can even just do it on your own, just have some fun with it, just embellish it here and there, like, right? Let's say you're just jamming on a G minor chord. Maybe go to C minor. Repeat. Maybe play it higher. Right? So you could just play simple chords and bring it in wherever. That was the add 2. So let's bring in some ads, flat six. Maybe take a major. More brighter with the add two. Maybe the other one. Try it at different pitches if you want. Back to minor. Since the pedal is held, you can kind of either play arpeggios or you can kind of play some blocks. Like, so maybe like a yes, I am getting a bit carried away, but I'm trying to show you the application. It's not like you play a G minor chord, wait for the singer to finish, you know, still stuck there. Singer's getting over, and now, you know, you don't have to just do it just because you can do it. You should do it because the song also needs it, right? So maybe you could, at the compositional stage, you could bring in these fillers and see how that flavor works as well. So now we've kind of exhausted the minor sixth embellishment, also known as the augmented fifth. I guess when you use the major third, you call it the aug five. Now you call it the minor sixth. So now let's do the other sixth. What is the other sixth available? The major sixth, or the sixth in the major scale. Or just the major sixth, because the major sixth could be there even in like a minor third or a minor vibe. For example, the Dorian scale has the major sixth in it. Even the melodic minor. There even with a minor domain. So that's why I would like to add that as well. So what does an add 6 do? This is the vibe. Okay, so you do 1-3-5 back to major. Almost like a penta scale, right? Sometimes I sneak in that A because that creeps the pentatonic scale in. But just get used to this. So the resultant chord you're shredding on is actually the G major sixth chord, right? So the G, B, D, cross to E, which is the add 6. Repeat. For information, if you do this on F sharp, it's really easy. It's just the entire pentatonic scale is right there. You can have some fun on F sharp if you didn't know that. Okay, coming to minor with an added major sixth. That's, I think, one of the last embellishments for the day. So you go right. I'm just trying to take the major and the minor chord and just transform it a bit, you know, if you can, or if that's even possible, right, guys? So yeah, we've done add 2, we've done add 6, we've done add flat 6. One thing remains, that's the add 4. Okay, some people also call that the suspended 4. So if you have to do an add 4, well, you play your chord, then you add the C. Very common sound. right? I'm reminded of the Baywatch theme from way, way long ago, right? So you get that sound, right? You could either do it with just the suspended chord. You can ignore the third, or you add the third, which gives you a more interesting sound. You can build a lick or two around that, or just practice as an exercise. So, back to our usual drill. How does this work with minor? Quite well, I guess. Change your bass, it'll transform the sound. These arpeggios, when you add those notes, it kind of goes with most of the common chords you would anyways have written in your song. So it's a good way to kind of, you could even consider this from a from an arrangement angle, where you could kind of program this or play it on a synthesizer or on like a loop kind of environment or a loop based instrument, and let that ring for the whole song, you know, somewhere in the background. And it can be like this arpeggio effect, you know, which you can actually play, unlike some of the modern music where people kind of draw these notes, which won't get you that good results. The human way of playing a run can also be brought into like an electronic song or something like that, which I found some good results with, if you ask me, right? Unless it gets really fast, then you need a machine to take over. Okay, so these are about all the runs, guys. I'm going to recap everything. I know I've drifted along the way, so do hang around for just a couple more minutes while I will recap all of the runs once. So let's start with G major with the added 2. And then G minor with the added 2. Then I'm going to do G major with the added 6. Then the normal 6, like that, right? You get the drift. So there's going to be maybe about 8 variations in this arpeggio run. And I'll do it on triplets for ease of understanding. That'll be da 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 da. Okay? So G major or major chord with an add 2. Practiced in the descending start. Minor chord with an add 2. Minor chord with an add 2 from the descending direction. Okay, major chord with a sharp 5 creates an augmented flavor, right? Triplets again. Okay, minor chord with the same flat 6, giving you that sci-fi X-Files like vibe. Do it in semi-quavers like I'm doing now, groupings of 4, or groupings of 3s would also work. Descending version. Remember, in some cases you'll have to cross your ring finger. In some cases you'll have to cross your middle. So that's a job you have to figure out. But while crossing, I tend to remind my students to not kind of move their elbow. At least students who I can see when I'm teaching, don't turn your elbow, because then your entire body will lose its shape, so to speak. So try to, even if you're crossing, let the wrist cross, and if you see, my elbow is still stuck to the body pretty much, right? You can move your whole body if you'd like, but I don't encourage sudden jerky motions of the elbow, because that can also hurt your wrist if you overdo it with your elbow. So be a bit careful with runs. Sometimes it gets a bit sporting-like, so you kind of overdo it. Take breaks, take regular breaks while doing this stuff. Coming back, where we do normal six with a major chord. Same story with a minor chord in the major sixth. I like this sound. Groupings of four right there. Okay. Yeah. And so the last grouping was the sus4, which is the C in the middle of the B and the D. There we go. You may want to remember to cross over your middle finger in this case. You can get some good speed there. Always try to practice in reverse direction as well, starting with the top end. So you never know how you're going to play it, you know, how it just comes out for the purpose of the song. Ideally, you want to do all these things to serve the song as best as possible. So you don't want to do what you know how, you know, you'd rather have a bank of these things waiting for you, and then in the song you can kind of pick and choose, or it just kind of sometimes happens a bit organically. You don't even know how it got built, how that run happened. It just happens just to serve the song, and hopefully you realize you have a good bank of stuff to rely on. Last one was minor chord with a add four. Again, get your fingers going. For add four, you need to cross over the middle finger. Right, so when you practice this, always take breaks. As I said earlier, relax, take care of your wrist. Your forearms may also start burning, but protect your wrist, because your forearm can take a fair beating. Because to come back or to recover, you just don't play for a while. And yeah, whenever you feel a pain while doing fillers or runs, I would highly encourage you to take breaks or practice it slowly. These are the things which really matter. Practice it slowly. I know the eventual intention is to kind of show off and, you know, do this on stage and go crazy. You know, these are things we love to do, and I would highly encourage you to learn such things. But we have to realize it's a physical job, because you're playing much faster, and at the same time you need to keep that control while playing. So don't lose the musical foundation, which is, are you playing triplets? Are you playing semi-quavers? You should know that. And a metronome will also help while you practice. Set the metronome to a slow speed and then try to divide it by three or divide it by four. These things can be used to make it a bit tight while you play. Also use it in context with the song. So if you take, let's say, a chord sequence of just two chords of G minor, maybe in the gap, play the filler. You know, this will give you more control. Down. Different chords. Right? So try to use it in context, use a metronome, relax, take your breaks. You don't think like this is a sport where you have to really burn your muscles, and you should not hurt your wrist while playing. That's the most important things, right? That all of these muscles and these parts of the body which are near the fingers, the wrist and around here, these are very, very feeble if you ask me, right? It's not evolved that well, so try to relax these muscles always when you play. The shoulder, the arms, the forearms, all of that can take a beating because we are used to that with our species, I guess. But the other muscles are very, very weak. So take care of those muscles. I tend to give it a go for about 10-15 minutes of rigorous practice. I'll just keep doing it. And then whether I'm tired or whether I'm not tired, I just stop playing. So that could be considered. So when you practice, just given a good amount of intensity for a short amount of time, 10 minutes or so, take a break and then come back to the job if you want, or do something else. Right, guys? So this is about how to add fillers, runs, or all these fancy arpeggio movements to your music. Hope you found the lesson useful. And as always, this is Jason here from Nathaniel School of Music. Do consider subscribing to our channel. Leave us a comment to tell us what you thought of this lesson. Like the video. It really helps the video move forward along the YouTube waves. And we also have our Patreon page, which you could consider being a part of. And well, if you actually want to do one of our courses, if you feel you like some kind of organized training, structured learning with certificates given to you, so on and so forth, do consider registering for our Music Method course, which is our flagship 4-month offering. You will find all the links to register on our website or in the forms provided in the description. Thank you for watching. Cheers.